parish faith mission as people of faith. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And you can all just be seated for a very brief moment. I'm not used to speaking at missions, so you'll have to bear with me. But I'm delighted to see you all here, and I thank you for coming. A few weeks ago, we issued our mission brochures, and on the front of the mission brochure, we had an invitation to come to our parish mission, or our parish faith mission, an invitation to come to pray, to listen, to sing. The theme of our parish faith mission is faith. Faith nourished, cherished, and celebrated, and lived. And I pray this evening that through gathering this evening here together, that our faith will be cherished, nourished, and will celebrate. And we'll go away from our service tonight strengthened to live out our faith more fully. The prayer of the mission is of the person in the Gospels who says to Jesus, "Lord, I believe, help my unbelief." We've come here this evening because we believe. We ask the Lord to help us in any unbelief, in any doubts we may have. And we ask the Lord especially that we gather this evening to strengthen our faith. Tonight we're offering special prayers at our mission ceremony this evening for our children, preparing for baptism, First Holy Communion, and confirmation and marriage, and for all our children and young people. And I'm delighted, I must say, to see so many of our children and our young people here this evening. Over the last week or so, we had petition prayers that we give out to the children from second to sixth class in our schools. And all of those petition prayers that we received back through the schools and the petition prayers that the children have brought are here in the box beside the shrine to Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Our mission is in honour and devoted to Our Lady of Perpetual Help. Perpetual means that she's always there for us. And Our Lady is always there for us as individuals, as family, as parish, as community, and in our world in general. And tonight, in a special way, we're praying for all of those petitions and for the petitions of each person that you bring this evening on your petition page and that you bring in the silence of your own hearts and in the silence of your own minds. Tonight, we won't like be calling a guest speaker, but I'm glad to have Father Declan Hurley with us here this evening. And we may have heard Declan before speaking to us at the time we went to Navan for the Year of Mercy, spoke there, and many other occasions Father Declan spoke to us as a deanery at local level. But I'm delighted to have Father Declan with us here this evening. And Father Declan is going to speak to us this evening about faith and the difference that faith makes in each of our lives. So now I'm going to invite you now to stand, and Declan, the other Declan, will lead us this evening in our opening hymn of our parish faith.
As I kneel before you.
14, page 30 in our red books.
We might just accept the invitation of that opening hymn where we said, as I kneel before you. Maybe we might just do that here this evening. We might kneel before the picture of Our Lady of Perpetual Heaven and we say the Novena prayer together. Mother of Perpetual Heaven, with the greatest confidence we come before your holy nature to be inspired by the example.
I'm the Lord.
servant is listening. You have the message of eternal life. Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "That is why I am telling you not to worry about your life and what you are to eat, nor about your body and how you are to clothe it. Surely life means more than food, and the body more than clothing. Look at the birds in the sky. They do not sow or reap or gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not worth much more than they are? Can any of you, for all his worrying, add one single cubit to his span of life? And why worry about clothing? Think of the flowers growing in the fields. They never have to work or spin. Yet I assure you that not even Solomon, all his regalia, was robed like one of these. Now if that is how God clothes the grass in the field, which is there today, and thrown into the furnace tomorrow, will he not much more look after you, O you of little faith? So do not worry. Do not say, what are we to eat, what are we to drink, how are we to be clothed? It is the pagans who set their hearts on all these things. Your heavenly Father knows you need them all. Set your hearts on his kingdom first, and on his righteousness, and all of these other things will be given you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will take care of itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." The Gospel of the Lord. Jesus. It's lovely to be here with you this evening, and thank you very, very much for the invitation. I feel very privileged and honoured to be here. So, Father Michael and Father Timothy, and to the parish team that has worked to prepare for this mission, thank you very, very much. And thank you for coming out in such numbers tonight on a cold, dark night like this. It's lovely to see so many of you here. And it's lovely to be here with another Declan as well. I love my name, Declan. And it's a beautiful ancient Irish name, which I believe means full of goodness or full of love. So I hope you're living up to your name. I'm doing my best. Which believe I've never baptized a Declan. In nearly 24 years as a priest, I don't know, I've baptized hundreds of children. I've yet to baptize a Declan. It went out of fashion for some reason. So if anybody here is thinking like that, if you're thinking about it, that's a nice name, I'll come back and baptize it. Is that okay for my name? I'd love to. There you go. So anyway, listen, it's lovely to be here and just to reflect with you at the start of your mission on faith and the difference that faith makes and the point of faith. You know, what is the point of faith? Because a lot of people nowadays, when they're asked about faith and religion, their first reaction is always, what's the point? But I think it's a great question. What is the point? What is the point of faith? I think it's a really, really important question. Most of the time when people say, what's the point? It's actually a rhetorical question. What they're saying is, there is no point. When Homer Simpson's wife, Marge, suggested that they go out for a night together, Homer replied, what's the point of going out? We're just going to come back here anyway. So, in Homer's view of things, going out was a waste of time. But people today say that there's no point in having faith. What are they saying? I think they're really saying something like this. I think they're saying faith doesn't really make a difference. People who have faith are no better off than those who have none. You don't have to have faith to be a good person. Some of the best people in the world are people who have no faith, they say. Or maybe they think that faith is old-fashioned, a bit naive, a bit superstitious, maybe. Maybe they think that if you want to be a really modern person nowadays, you can get by perfectly well without having God in your life. And then other people who say that there's no point to faith, they say, well, I live my life as best I can, I try not to hurt anybody. I don't need to live by the rules of some ancient religion based on stories that couldn't possibly be true. And then some people say, I put my faith in myself and I put my faith in other people, not in an invisible God. And on the answers go. Those interviews that get burned in with people about faith, a lot of them are full of those kind of answers. A lot of people basically saying that they didn't see the point. But let's try to answer that question here tonight. Let's ask the question, what is the point? What difference does it make? What is the point of faith? And let's make it practical. I'm going to try and make it as practical as I can. I want to bring it down to basics. I'm even going to make it personal. I'm not going to talk about myself. I'm going to talk about, first of all, the people here in Rathmullan who laid the foundation stone for this church 50 years ago. And who went on then to build this church. The parishioners and the priests of Rathmullan and Enfield, Jordanstown, 50 years ago. Perhaps some of the older parishioners here this evening can remember that time. And you can remember when this church was being built, you can remember the fundraising, you can remember the big community effort that was needed to build this church. What was the point? What was the point of building this church? I'm looking at Father Michael. Now, he won't appreciate me for drawing attention to him in this way, but it has to be done. We were in ministry together. I remember him preparing for his ordination. And since his ordination, he's given, I think, the best part of his adult life serving in the parishes of Summerhill, and now here in Enfield, Rathmullan. 27 years, am I right? Serving the people of this part of County Meath, the best part of his adult life. What was the point? I see Father Timothy. He has left his home, his family, and his diocese in Nigeria to come here and to serve in this parish, which I'd safely say he never ever heard of until he came. Don't worry, he never heard of that either, so I'll say that we're the seminary. But, you know, he's here, he's serving here, he's doing some study, which hopefully he'll put to good use in the service of the church back in Nigeria sometime in the future. But again, I ask, what's the point? Well, some of you here tonight are the parents of children preparing for the sacraments of Holy Communion and Confirmation in the parish schools. You want your child to have those sacraments. You receive them as a child. You want the same for your child. You don't want your child to be denied or deprived what you had when you were their age. What's the point? And all of you, all of us here tonight, we've all left the comfort of our homes this cold dark night. You can be at home watching your favourite soap or the latest reality TV show or just relaxing, but you're here. And if you're here, I'm presuming that you're also people who generally go to Mass on Sundays and are generally happy to be part of the life of this parish. And again I ask, what's the point? It's a big question. As a younger priest, just out of seminary, I would have been very convinced of the theological answers and the philosophical answers to that question. And I still am convinced that there are some very convincing arguments for why there's a point to faith and why faith makes a difference. But as I've lived and worked as a priest, I've become more and more convinced, not by theological arguments, but by what I've seen first. I've been convinced by people that there is a point to faith. I've been convinced by good, normal people. People who would be shocked to think that they are models of faith for me, because they don't see themselves as being heroic in any way. They don't see themselves as being kind of different. So in that sense, I'm speaking tonight more from experience than from knowledge. I'm more convinced by what I've seen and experienced than by what I've learned. There's a good joke about how we all end up speaking from experience, because that's basically all we have at the end of the day, is experience. There was apparently an international literary competition one time to write a book, and the title for the book was specifically The Elephant. So there was lots of entries. So the German man wrote Das Elephant, 4 volumes, the definitive book on everything you needed to know about the elephant. And the English man wrote The Elephant and Hunting in India. And the French man wrote L'Elephant et l'Amour, The Elephant and Love. And the Irish man wrote The Elephant and My Fight for Irish Freedom. So, I suppose, no matter what, we all come back to our experience. And as I say, I've been blessed to witness the faith of people, which has led me to say, yes, there is a point. It does make a difference. In Navan, we have a 24-hour adoration chapel in St. Mary's Church. I can look out the window of the parochial house at any hour of the day or night. I see people coming and going. I can look out at 2 a.m., at 3 a.m., at 4 a.m., and there they are, coming to and going from their hour of prayer before the Blessed Sacrament. And I ask them, why do they do it? And some of them say, it's like looking into heaven. Some of them say, it gives me great peace. Others say it gives me courage to face my daily struggles. Others say, I just sit there and God speaks to me in my heart. One person told me, she said, I feel loved there. What's obvious is that these are not people just going through some routine, it's not a hobby. Or they're not just trying to pass the time when they can't sleep. These are people for whom faith makes a difference. One woman told me something recently. She shared something with me that has actually shaken me. I hope I never forget her words, because I've been thinking about her ever since. She has an adult daughter with quite severe special needs. And she told me how one time, not long after the birth of her daughter, many years ago, she went into the church in Navan and she knelt before the altar. And she looked up at her beautiful crucifix over the altar and she said, Lord, I can't do this. And she just cried and cried. But she said to me, I never looked back from that day. It hasn't been easy, but my daughter is my greatest joy. I actually get a get a bit emotional when I think of her words, because I suppose I just wish I had her faith. What happened in that moment? What happened when she was pouring out her tears like that in front of the altar? Let me try and offer you an explanation of what I think happened. I think in that moment she accepted her daughter as a gift. Everybody had been telling her that she'd be given a cross. And yes, let's not pretend otherwise than she had. But somehow, at that moment, she accepted her cross as a gift. She welcomed her daughter as a gift from God. She began to see her daughter as grace. And when she could begin to see her child as a gift, she was able to welcome her. She could see her child as God-given. And despite all the daily challenges, and there have been many, and despite all the sacrifices and all the pain, there has been joy. Because she has been able to see her daughter as a gift. And she has become the mother she never knew she could become. And she has given of herself in ways that she never thought or imagined she would have to give of herself. But there has been joy. And she has been able to live all those years, despite all the challenges, she has been able to hold on to a sense of gratitude. She has been able to live life with gratitude and with the joy and the hope that come from that. And actually, her daughter's name is Anne. And she never knew until I told her that the name Anne comes from the Hebrew name Hannah, which means given. In other words, given by God. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could all accept all our trials as gift? My favourite saint, the beautiful and extraordinary Saint Therese, the little flower, she said, everything is grace. And it's only since my chat with Anne's mother that I've begun to realise actually the true meaning of that. Everything comes from God. Everything is gift. Everything is given. And if we can welcome what God gives us, then we can find hope and we can find joy. Because otherwise we're fighting it. And we're living in anger and we're constantly stressed. And we resent others for the happiness we perceive they have. And we resent God for making us carry what seems unbearable. But it doesn't have to be that way. And I didn't have to be told this by the Pope. I didn't have to study to learn it. There's a woman in Navan who showed me that there is another way. And it's the way of faith that tells us that everything is gift. Everything is grace. And if we can just welcome everything that God gives us, there is joy and there is hope. Things don't change, the reality stays the same. And there's no miraculous lifting of all the challenges and all the pain. But the miracle happens in the heart because it becomes possible to welcome it all as a gift. I'll move on to a totally different experience, not a happy one. Please bear with me on this one. Since Christmas, I've buried two young men who both said, what's the point? But in their cases, they weren't talking about faith the way we are tonight, they were talking about life itself. And in their cases, they came to the conclusion that there was no point. I know they probably didn't know what they were doing, and I know we should have compassion for them. But they had other choices. Both left young children who would have to grow up without a father. Both of them left families and friends that left to carry the terrible burden of guilt and anger and grief for a long time to come. And we're all aware of the this plague affecting our society at the moment, especially young men. What is happening to young men? Those two young men were both sons of God, created by God, given the gift of life by a loving God who created them for the very same purpose that he created all of us, to know his love and to live in his love now and there. The day they were baptized, God said to each one of them, "You are my son. I love you. I will never abandon you. I will never withdraw my love from you." All of us received the exact same promise, the exact same assurance that our life has a purpose, our life has a meaning. But we're told that we don't need God. And young men are telling one another that they don't need God. That's wrong. We're doing an injustice to one another when we say that, because when we lose sight of God, we lose sight of the fundamental truth at the heart of our very existence, that we are loved and that our life has a purpose. And when we lose sight of that, what is there? There is nothing. There is only darkness. And it becomes very easy to say, what's the point? It all comes back to that word again, gift. Isn't that what it's all about? Isn't that the difference? I can choose to welcome my life as a gift from God, or I can choose to see my life as something that I didn't choose. The problem is, if I don't welcome my life as a gift, everything that brings unhappiness is an injustice. But I end up fighting. But I only end up fighting with myself because I can't accept who I am. And I end up being consumed by anger and resentment towards the people or the things that are causing me to feel unhappy. But faith in a loving God allows us to accept life as a gift. To welcome it as a gift from a God who loves me and who has a plan for me. And even though at times I find it very hard to see what his plan is for me, and even though at times his loving plan seems very cruel and too much full of pain, but if I have enough faith to trust him to know what he is doing, then I can find hope and maybe even joy. Those of you who are parents here tonight, especially those of you who are parents of children preparing for the sacraments, this is the point. The whole point of Holy Communion and Confirmation is to help your child to grow in the knowledge that he or she is loved by God and precious in his sight. That their life has value, not just now, but forever. Their life has a purpose. They're not just an accident of biology. They've been created by a loving God who will never withdraw his love from them. So, dear parents, think of the value of your child carrying that conviction, that belief, into their adult years. Think of the hope it can offer them. I know it's something you would want for your child. Don't allow yourself to be convinced by those who would say there is no point. There is a point. It's about how your child can embrace his or her future with hope. I'll just share one other final thing with you. Recently, I was invited to watch a documentary film called Apparition Hill. It's about Medjugorje. I've never had the need to go, but I was invited to watch this documentary. And in the film, a number of people were randomly chosen to make a pilgrimage to Medjugorje, and the cameras followed them on their pilgrimage. Some were atheists, some were people of faith, but they all had questions, and we were given this fly on the wall perspective of their experience. And one woman was a young mother with two young children, and she has terminal cancer. She was extraordinary, I was very moved by her. At one point, she talks to the camera, just on her own, to the camera, and she shares her deepest fear. She says that when she has to go away somewhere, and she has to get a child minder, she can't go 1 hour without wondering how are the children and checking in with the child minder to see if everything is okay. And her fear is, when she has to go away forever, how can she trust? How can she trust that they'll be okay? I'm not a parent, I'll never know that fear. But I've been really cut to the core of how she articulated that fear. And there's a beautiful moment in the film when she comes back from a time of prayer, and she comes before the camera again, and the tears are streaming down her face, and she says, I trust. In the face of the unknown, when we're in the grip of our greatest fear, faith allows us to say, I trust. That's the miracle. Reality doesn't change. She didn't get some miraculous cure. She still has cancer. But it becomes possible for us to trust, and therefore to find hope, and maybe even joy. That's the point. So, my dear friends, people who built this church 50 years ago, Father Michael and Father Timothy, giving their lives to serve as priests, all of us here tonight, what is the point? The point is that God loves us. He has created us. Our lives are a gift. Everything is gift. And when Father Michael and Father Timothy stand at this altar here, or at the altar in Jordanstown, and they celebrate Eucharist, the word means to give thanks. The point is that we're being reminded every Sunday and every day that everything is gift. And if we can welcome the gift with thanks, with gratitude, well then hope is possible and joy is possible. That is the point.
And in the silence of our own hearts now, our own minds, we bring our own private prayers and intentions, the intentions that we bring and want to pray for as part of our parish faith mission. And we kneel now for a moment. Father Timothy on page 12 will lead us in some prayers and petitions about our mission booklet. Page 12 in our red booklets, page 10 in our pink booklets. And the response to each of the prayers is, Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy.
We cry to you on behalf of the world.
Lord,
that we may love and care for the head, sea, and air. That we may love and care for all your people. For those whose humanity is destroyed by hunger. For those whose humanity is destroyed by the abuse of power. For those whose humanity is destroyed by the sins of others. For those who are lost and lonely. For all who are sick and dying. Let us pray. Father, it is good for us to be here and to live in our hearts and our hearts.
We rejoice in
evening. We hope that the memorable night for you, you'll always spend. people said in the last couple of weeks. I've never mentioned it before. So I hope you've been enriched this evening and uplifted and filled with joy and hope to share it tonight on the first night of our parish faith mission. And especially want to thank the two deacons this evening and their goodness.
Yeah,
it's a great day.